Well, thank you very much for the invitation to come and speak today, and thank you to all of you for coming along. So this this work arises from my interest in the Weimar photographic book, and in particular Ernst Friedrich's book, Krieg dem Krieg, is a war against war, which I'll be talking about quite a lot, and it's an attempt to kind of say something about war against war that isn't banal or self-evident, and well, you'll take a view on whether that succeeds or not. So I'm sure that all of you here know that the Weimar Republic spanned the 14 years between the end of the First World War and the naming of Hitler as Chancellor of Germany in January 1933. It's generally seen as a period of profound paradox, in that the extraordinary level of cultural innovation and vibrancy that we associate with the short life of the Republic took place against a backdrop of periodic economic crisis and persistent political turmoil. A recent historiography on Weimar has tended to dwell less on crisis, actually, than on the opportunities for change that went hand in hand with the political instability of the early Weimar years. So the revolutions of late 1918 and early 1919, and the rapid transition from authoritarian monarchy to parliamentary democracy, brought in their wake hitherto unimaginable transformations of the public sphere. And one of the tasks of the first Weimar government was thus to map, in the words of Kathleen Canning, new relationships among the civic, family and state in the name of democracy, and to reconstitute the state to make space for the claims of a newly empowered citizenry. While the First World War and the revolutions that succeeded it led to the erosion of the structures of class and corporation that had dominated the Wilhelmine period, they allowed an array of new collectivities to come into existence. And some of these were represented by Weimar's numerous political parties, but there were also many non-parliamentary political groups that coalesced around the new structures of citizenship and political freedoms that were called into being by the Weimar Constitution. So under the pressure of war and revolution, the German public sphere was fundamentally reconfigured. Changes in the nature of the state, in the nature of censorship legislation, technologies of representation and social structure reconstituted the public sphere as one of mass participation and new forms of verbal visual address. Among the groups that emerged in the wake of war were a variety of pacifist organisations. Now, Weimar pacifists were actually quite a diverse bunch. There were feminist pacifists, there was the Deutsche Friedensgesellschaft, or the German Peace Society, which was aimed at constitutional and social change, the Nie wieder Krieg Bewegung, which attempted to develop a kind of grassroots pacifism, there was an organised Catholic pacifist movement, there was the Bund der Kriegsdienstgegner, so the Anti-Conscription League, as well as pacifist factions within some of the major parties. Well, pacifism and anti-militarism already had a long history in Germany by this point. The Weimar Republic provided conditions under which new forms of pacifist activism and discourse became possible. So, as histories of German pacifism have shown, the pacifist movement in Weimar rapidly paralysed itself, partly as a consequence of internal divisions, and became politically more or less ineffectual, certainly by the latter end of the 1920s. The cultural products of Weimar pacifism, on the other hand, continue to trouble and intrigue. By coincidence, I think 1924 marks a high point of pacifist cultural production. Among the signature artefacts of that year are Käthe Kollwitz's poster Nie wieder Krieg, Otto Dix's portfolio of etchings Der Krieg, from which here are two images. And the two works I'm going to talk about today, Ernst Friedrich's photo book Krieg im Kriege, War Against War, which was published in four languages. So always German, French and English, and then the fourth language fluctuated, Dutch, Russian. And this photomontage by John Heartfield, so 18 Jahren, Väter und Söhne, so 10 years on, fathers and sons. In what follows, I offer less a formal or content analysis than an investigation into the constitution of publics by photographic means, as a way, hopefully then, of understanding the claims that photography can legitimately make as a form of political intervention, and the hopes that we might justifiably invest in it. So starting with Krieg dem Kriege, War Against War, Ernst Friedrich was an anarchist pacifist, and this is him on the podium there. He was an anarchist pacifist who sought nothing less than a dismantling of the state as a form of political organisation and the total reconfiguration of child-rearing practices in the service of future peace. Among his many pacifist activities was the founding of an anti-war museum in Berlin in 1923. And the following year, he published the photo book, War Against War, in which he reproduced many of the images that he had collected for his anti-war museum. Towards the end of War Against War, Friedrich includes the following appeal. So this is an appeal to human beings of all lands to place more pictures at my disposal. I request comrades and sympathisers to send me, by registered post, war photographs, war reports, army orders, speeches, etc., in order that the material that has been collected for years may be made as complete as possible, and that the International Anti-War Museum, founded by me, may be further extended. All placards, pictures, songs, poems, books, toy soldiers, war souvenirs, statuettes, coffee cups with war slogans painted on them, handkerchiefs on which war pictures are printed, and in short, all things... All things that in any way are connected with war and militarism are urgently needed for our museum. The photographs and other objects sent in will, if desired, be returned after a copy has been made for the museum. All journals and magazines sympathising with us are requested to reproduce the present appeal. So I think what's interesting about this appeal, which on the face of it is actually quite banal, is what it tells us about the relationship between visual culture, forms of public address, and political agitation. So this is a direct address, made in the medium of print, to no one in particular, apparently assuming the existence of the comrades and sympathisers, which it, in fact it rhetorically constructs. It maps its own interdiscursive terrain by mentioning numerous documents and other artefacts, photographs, reports, army orders, speeches, and the home front material culture of war, in order to establish the terms of its own intelligibility. At the same time, it articulates a clear position in relation to this existing discursive field, governed by the interlinked triad of pacifism, collection, and display. Friedrich's appeal also assumes that his text will generate feedback, that it will be received and responded to, and that the readership of this appeal will indeed contribute items to his collection. And finally, the text presupposes a broader public discourse on pacifism, within which it will itself circulate. So the reason this is relevant is it's closely aligned, I think, with the understanding of publics outlined by the public sphere theorist Michael Warner. So Warner argues, first of all, that publics are self-organising, so they're constituted by through nothing but discourse. So a public exists by virtue of being addressed. Secondly, a public is a relation between strangers. So public address creates imagined communities of readers and listeners among individuals who do not know and never meet each other. Thirdly, publics are constituted through a form of address that's both personal and impersonal. So to be addressed as a public, one has to assume that public discourse is addressed to oneself, while also being addressed to an indefinite number of strangers with whom one thereby enters into some kind of remote virtual relationship. A public comes into being by means of mere attention. One's only part of a public insofar as one pays attention to the discourse that constitutes it. And membership of a public is therefore a form of voluntary association. And then finally, a public is, in Warner's sense, and I'll go on to sort of take issue with this a little bit later, in Warner's sense, it's a virtual social space that comes into being through the reflexive circulation of discourse. So since a public is an ongoing space of encounter, no single text is sufficient in itself to constitute it. So publics are constituted over time through intertextual circulation. So in light of this, Friedrich's War Against War looks like an exemplary case of Warner's public discourse. Friedrich is able to both presuppose and call into being a public of pacifist sympathisers within a polity that suddenly finds itself available for new kinds of affiliation or stranger sociability that are constituted then by the possession, exchange and consumption of numerous texts and other artefacts. What interests me particularly, though, is the ways in which Friedrich seems to constitute a counter-public. So Warner helpfully distinguishes between what he calls an alternative or an oppositional or subaltern public on the one hand, and a counter-public on the other. So in classical public sphere theory, public address is conceived on the model of rational critical dialogue, based on the circulation of statements whose propositional content is reasonably clear and reasonably stable. I'll come back to the importance of that later on. The difference between oppositional publics and dominant or hegemonic publics is this one of content rather than of kind, fundamentally. Counterpublics, on the other hand, are not merely oppositional or subaltern, but constitute themselves by reanimating that which normative public discourse elides, so namely the expressive and affective aspects of discourse and the embodied nature of the subject. So Warner argues that the idea of a bourgeois public depends on the disembodied nature of its constitutive discourse. A counterpublic, properly understood, refuses this elision of the body, indeed makes the body itself a site for interpolation and a vehicle of stranger sociability. So I would challenge Warner's insistence on the absence of the body in the constitution of conventional publics, for reasons that I'll go on to explore in a minute, but precisely how that body is mobilised is a really crucial issue, which I will turn to. So coming back to Friedrich then, I'd like to think first of all about the photo book in which the appeal circulated. The photo book was an emerging genre that was enabled by an increasingly image-saturated print culture. I think the rise of the illustrated press, the illustrated periodical, was one of the defining characteristics of Weimar cultural life, and the visual forms and habits of reading cultivated by the illustrated press had a significant impact on the rise of photo books and indeed their reception. But the mode of circulation of images that's invoked by Friedrich's appeal to human beings of all lands is indebted to journalistic practices that had actually begun during the First World War. So Bufa, the German propaganda agency during World War I, finding itself perpetually unable to fulfill journalistic demand for images, made repeated appeals to citizens to send in photographs for distribution to newspaper editors. So the notion of submitting images for publication as a form of participation in the public sphere had thus been established during the war years, but very much as part of the national project. Friedrich turns the same process to anti-nationalist and anti-militarist ends. The photographic collection that Friedrich established was set up as an explicit counter-discourse that purports to present the truth of war. So here are some typical examples of war against war, and you can see that the images work in tandem with text, and the texts almost throughout work by means of a fairly crude irony. So what you tend to get is a slogan culled from popular culture or from speeches by German politicians and generals, juxtaposed with the reality of trench warfare. So, you know, we have here, there's no sweeter death in the world than to die fighting the enemy. Okay, and then you get this particular image, and this is just reproduced time after time after time throughout War Against War. So the truth of war, as represented in these photographs, though, is legible not purely by means of text-image relationships here, but also because of the general repertoire of sanitized war imagery with which the German public would have been already familiar as a consequence of the management of information during World War I by Bufa. The Friedrich's interpolation of an oppositional pacifist public thus presupposes familiarity with dominant militarist public discourse and its attendant image world. But stranger sociability, which in Warner's view is a defining feature of publics, is not something that is experienced exclusively in private communion with verbal or visual representations. And this is where I think I begin to part company with Warner. I think that stranger sociability is also a question of inhabiting shared spaces, public spaces, in other words, among which we might number the museum. When thinking about visual culture and its forms of address, then it's highly significant, I think, that Friedrich established an anti-war museum in central Berlin in 1923. So as we know from the work of scholars such as Tony Bennett, the museum as a state-sponsored enterprise arose more or less concurrently with the Habermasian bourgeois public sphere and was closely linked to the consolidation of European nation-states and their apparatus of legitimation. So the typical museums of the 19th century fulfilled several interlinked functions. In epistemological terms, they reordered geological, biological, and ethnographic knowledge in such a way as to position the Western viewing subject as the pinnacle of natural and cultural achievement. In geopolitical terms, they were organized to reflect the distinctiveness of the historical lineage of the nation to control, therefore, the national narrative. And then in biopolitical terms, they formed part of the general move away from the spectacular display of monarchic power and towards an exercise of power that was reliant on the non-coercive disciplining of bodies. The museum was seen as a civilizing institution opposed to sites of raucous assembly such as travelling fairs or taverns, and imposing upon the visitor specific standards of comportment. The museum was to function, in Bennett's words, as a space of emulation in which civilized forms of behaviour might be learnt and thus diffused more widely through the social body. Museums were thus constructed as spaces of observation and regulation, where the mutual visibility of visitors would mould the individual body to the requirements of new forms of public conduct. So stranger sociability then was a product of visibility. Firstly, of the visibility to each other of strangers who are nevertheless addressed as a public by the museum and who recognise themselves as the public so addressed. And secondly, of the visibility of artefacts and other exhibits that confirm that public as superior to all other epochs and regions. The museum constituted the bourgeois body and its standards of comportment as the norm. Unlike the disembodied nature of print culture, however, it also foregrounded that body as the site for the inscription and performance of that norm. So just as the new legal, political, technological and social constellations of the early Weimar Republic facilitated certain forms of print culture, so they also enabled new ways of constructing and controlling public space, which in turn offered new fora for visual display. So the idea of a semi-permanent, publicly accessible institution propagating an anti-war message would, I think, have been completely unthinkable in Imperial Germany. But it becomes thinkable in the fledgling Republic. So the question is, what happens to the museum when it's designed not to civilise necessarily, but to provoke? When it's designed to shock and appall as well as enlighten? When its political rationality is openly displayed rather than tacit? When it offers a narrative of the West's unparalleled barbarism and reveals the body as nothing more than a lump of flesh? Thinking about the German context in particular, what happens when a museum deliberately subverts the historical narrative of the state, which was, of course, deeply marked by militarism? The answer is that the anti-war museum in the centre of Berlin was a multiple blow. It was aimed not just at the military, but also at the cultural institutions of the state, and beyond that, at the very notion of civilization and any sense of Western cultural superiority. Now, there's one further sense in which Friedrich subverted the notion of the museum, and that's through his exploitation of another cultural form that characterised Weimar, and that was the shop window. Since the invention of plate glass in the mid-19th century, as we will all know from our reading of Benjamin, display windows had grown in size and had become a marker of the new department stores, amongst other spaces. Their importance for the consumer economy was such that special schools and professional associations for Schaufensterdekorateure, so window dressers, were established, and by 1930 Germany had some 6,000 professional window dressers. The typical Weimar display window was seen, in the words of Janet Ward, as a vital interactive spatial membrane along the newly streamlined facades of metropolitan buildings. Now we can't say that of Friedrich's museum. It was set up in an old house, it was relatively small, and this precluded then the kind of phantasmagorial extravagance of department store display windows. But he nevertheless drew on the aesthetics of the display window, I think, aligning his project with sensation and consumerism and foregrounding precisely those aspects of voyeurism and desire that the museum both trades on and conventionally seeks to suppress. So the anti-war museum as a site of display is, of course, a crucial factor if we're thinking about photography as public discourse. Photographs were central to its rhetoric. Contemporary installation shots show a medley of objects. So I apologise for the poor quality. It's extraordinarily difficult to find good quality installation shots of Friedrich's museum. So this is the best I could do, I'm afraid. They show a medley of objects spread on tables. You can see some tin soldiers, you can see a picket halberd, you know, one of those spiked First World War helmets. There are etchings by Otto Dix on the wall, and photographs are packed into display cases or hung haphazardly on the walls. Now, the external window of the museum was also packed with photographs, including images of seriously injured veterans, and I'll return to those later. Suffice it to note for now that the anti-war museum thus sought to extend its control over space outwards, claiming a portion of the street by means of photographic exhibition. So rather than being an edifying portal to culture, though, the exterior of the anti-war museum took the form of a shop window and offered a spectacle that was horrifying and fascinating in equal measure. In so doing, it addressed a very different kind of public from that addressed by the conventional museum, of course. In part, it's a public that is constituted by being taken unawares, shocked into paying attention or refusing to pay attention by the sudden attempt to occupy public space photographically. In other words, the anti-war museum addressed a public born of interwar urban modernity, a public that needed to be appealed to in a state of distraction, not one that needed to undertake a pilgrimage to a place of cultural reverence in order to be addressed as a public. Our willingness to process a passing appeal determines which publics we belong to, writes Warner. The direction of our glance, he adds, can constitute our social world. In other words, then, modern publics are created by primarily visual means, a fact that Friedrich understood and exploited in his anti-war museum. But Friedrich's shock tactics in the public arena had further ramifications, as some of the photographs of wounded veterans that he exhibited had already appeared in the communist press in the immediate post-war period. Now, however, the museum and its exhibits rapidly became well known through reviews and reports in the bourgeois press, such as this one in the Berliner Volkszeitung, which themselves contained photographs. So the visual culture of pacifism came to insinuate itself into the home, addressing a different public, of course, demanding a more conventional mode of immersive attention, perhaps, and possibly then leading to a visit to the anti-war museum itself, in person. Publics, according to Warner, are constituted by the temporality of the relevant forms of discursive circulation, with politics taking much of its character from the temporality of the headline, not the archive. It's an argument that Warner makes. But in Friedrich's case, there's an intriguing relay then between the headline and the archive, as newspaper images are retooled, integrated into the semi-permanence of the museum, and then recirculated in the news media in a way that extends and prolongs their political efficacy. Furthermore, we've already seen that Friedrich's book War Against War included an appeal to donate war-related domestic objects to the museum. The museum not only addressed, but was partly constituted in its materiality then by the public. What Friedrich's example suggests is that in the visual photographic construction of publics, there's a constant transfer between public space, print culture, and the domestic sphere. The most striking, shocking, and contentious exhibits in Friedrich's museum were images of soldiers with horrific facial injuries, as I've alluded to. Friedrich displayed them prominently in his museum, indeed in the window of his museum, and they were later incorporated into War Against War. Now, the reception history of War Against War is dominated by a discussion of this relatively slim choir of images of facially wounded veterans. And it demonstrates remarkable consistency over time. So in 1926, Kurt Tucholsky, I will show you those images in a moment, Kurt Tucholsky reviewed War Against War in the left-wing journal Die Weltbühne, and he wrote, "No writer, not even the greatest, can match the power of the image as a weapon. Whoever looks upon this and does not shudder is not human." Now, this mode of reception then continued more or less unchanged for 80 years, with Susan Sontag writing in her 2003 book regarding the pain of others that the images are shocking and excruciating, and then she says next to nothing else about them. So there's broad consensus that War Against War was an attempt at social intervention, and it was an artifact that sought to act upon people. But few of the critics who have written about War Against War say much beyond noting how horrific the photographs are. And I wonder if this critical impasse actually suggests that horror is not the right category here. I wonder instead that what's really going on here is the stimulation of disgust. So theorists of disgust have noted that the decaying corpse and the mutilated body, displaying on the outside what should remain invisibly within, bone, soft tissue, blood, pus, excreta, etc., are the preeminent stimuli of disgust reactions. In this light, the numerous corpses piled up in Krieg im Kriege, War Against War, can be seen as obvious sources of disgust. This is particularly true of facial disfigurements, which disrupt the usual function of bodily orifices. So these are some of the ones where surgery was more successful, and here are some of the more appalling facial wounds. The mouth has always been a troubling sight for Western aesthetics. It's the part of the body that offers access to and has the capacity to display the bodily interior. So in classical aesthetics, the open mouth was repudiated as a potential cause of disgust, and classical art kept mouths firmly closed. And just as an aside, photographic technology was able to capture a smile at a relatively early stage in its technical development, if you like. But the tradition of the closed mouth and the poker face remains beyond that point, precisely because of a taboo on smiles. It was not a technologically determined convention. So the images in Friedrich's book, on the other hand, show mouths that are grotesquely not only open but shut away, or in the best case scenario, as in here, surgically replaced with a stoma. In some cases, the soldiers depicted return the camera's gaze and allow eye contact, which, as the anthropologist Alfred Gell notes, to look is the basic mechanism of intersubjectivity. Okay, he writes that to look into another's eyes is not just to see the other, but to see the other seeing you. But these are largely medical images, and as in criminal or ethnographic portraits, this intersubjectivity is already attenuated by the visually encoded power relationships that rob the other of full subjectivity and preclude proper intersubjectivity. Now, I think when we're also confronted with destroyed mouths and missing jaws, which show that all that's inside is animal flesh or a gaping void, rather than sort of subjectivity, a subjective interiority or mind that we might normally infer on the basis of eye contact, intersubjectivity becomes impossible, and in its place arises disgust. So it's important to note that disgust reactions are primarily bodily reactions. As Winfried Menninghaus, author of a very long study of disgust in Western aesthetic thought, points out, disgust circumvents the intellect as well as any thoughts of tolerance or compassion, and knows only the judgment of expulsion. So the term Menninghaus uses is erbrechen, you know, vomiting. Away with it, out of my stomach, out of my sight, out of my presence, he writes. It's here that we can perhaps connect the argument back to Tucholsky and Sontag and everybody else who's written in that particular tradition of reception of war against war. So Tucholsky uses the word Schaudern to shudder, and Sontag describes the images as excruciating, which literally means, of course, causing pain by torture. These are fundamentally corporeal responses. If this is indeed how Friedrich's book then acts upon the viewer, we can see war against war not merely as seeking to constitute an oppositional public of pacifists, but to produce a genuine counterpublic that depends not on the exercise of reason and the elision of the body, but on aversive bodily sensation. And that's what binds this particular virtual community together. I think, though, that mobilising disgust for political ends is quite a risky strategy. It's not so much that disgust is necessarily useless as a component of moral education. So for Kant, for example, the moral value of disgust resided precisely in the fact that it resulted in the avoidance or the removal of the object. And he opposed this to hatred, which in Kant's terms provoked reactions of extreme aggression aimed at the object's destruction. So one of the goals of moral education from a Kantian perspective was to substitute disgust for hatred as a way of kind of preventing exteriorized violence. To this extent, then, war against war can be seen as pursuing a vaguely Kantian agenda. But the problem is how you transform the desire to be rid of the offending presence, i.e. the image, into a desire to be rid of its ultimate cause, war, and behind that, at least in Friedrich's view, the system of European nation states that had led to the war in the first place. It's here that the affective, corporeal appeal of war against war becomes a problem, for unlike classical public discourse, it no longer functions in rational critical mode. Now, one of the benefits of the classical conception of the public sphere, which assumes that publics are constituted through the circulation of propositionally stable statements, as I mentioned right at the beginning, is that any member of a public can be reasonably certain that these statements are being read and understood in more or less the same way by all other members of that particular public. a counterpublic that's called into existence in part through the stimulation of highly affective somatic responses, however, might offer a much less stable form of stranger sociability. Thus, while for Tucholsky the ability to shudder at Friedrich's image was a marker of our common humanity, disgust manifested itself very differently among other representatives of Weimar society. The Berlin police removed 77 offending images from the display window of the anti-war museum. And the executive of the Bavarian Military League submitted the following statement to the Munich courts, which I'll produce in its German because the German is kind of amusing. War against war represents the most abysmal and calumnious slander of the Imperial Army, and by means of ill-intended juxtaposition seeks to denigrate the Imperial Army and make individual members thereof contemptible. We object to the continued existence of this book, which means, of course, out of my sight, out of my presence. Okay, so insofar as war against war led to opposition, it was opposition to Friedrich. Between 1923 and 1922, he was convicted no less than 13 times for infringement of press laws, libel laws, and laws to protect the Constitution. He was sent hate mail and numerous death threats by Nazi sympathisers even before the Nazis took power, and was placed in Schutzhaft, or protective custody, for 7 months as soon as Hitler became Chancellor. He only managed to escape death by fleeing through the mountains to Prague, or to Czechoslovakia rather, in the winter of 1933. Have I got time to say a few things about John Heartfield?
Yes, you do.
Yeah. And so I feel a little bit of a fraud in the sense that the picture that was used to advertise this talk will actually be talked about relatively little, but I will say a few things about Heartfield before winding up. So like Friedrich, Heartfield was a vocal critic of the militarism that he saw persisting in the culture of the Weimar Republic, but he employed very different means. So Nach 10 Jahren Väter und Söhne, 10 years on, Fathers and Sons, is the first of his politically charged photomontages and paved the way for the well-known work that appeared from the later 1920s through the 1930s in the Arbeiter Illustrierte Zeitung, so the Workers Illustrated News. This image combines a row of adult human skeletons and a full-length portrait of General Karl Litzmann and young, very, very young military cadets march across the lower part of the image. So a decade after mobilisation in 1914, Heartfield seems to argue, Germany is still in the grip of an authoritarian militarist ethos and is still preparing children and young men for war. The result will be their mass anonymous death. Well, I think there's more to it than this, because Heartfield's photomontage presents us with two fathers and two sets of sons. So the young sons are clearly, the young cadets are clearly the sons of the missing generation of fathers represented by the skeletons, and the skeletons are themselves the sons of the generation represented by Litzmann. But because that middle generation is represented as dead, and therefore absent, a further relationship of paternity is established between Litzmann and the young recruits. The German military state, as embodied by Litzmann, thus becomes the symbolic kind of Überfather that that repeatedly sends generations of its own sons to their deaths on the battlefield. Meanwhile, the living personification of the state, Litzmann himself, not only remains unscathed, but acquires ever more badges of approbation in the form of medals every time this happens. So the state is thus representing as congratulating itself on the cyclical slaughter of its own citizens. Now, there is, of course, also a self-reflexive moment at the heart of this montage. The master trope operative within the image, as the master tropes operative within the image, are those of production and reproduction. Humans' ability to reproduce themselves, society's willingness to reproduce soldiers through forms of education and indoctrination, and the capacity of war to mass-produce corpses. Photography is uniquely placed, of course, to activate this trope because it is itself characterized by what Walter Benjamin clumsily but accurately termed reproducibility. The skeletons are all the same skeleton, photographed from several slightly different angles, but nonetheless recognizable as the result of a reproduction process that is in principle infinite. The biological and social forms of reproduction that form the content of this image are thus mapped onto a technology of representation whose capacity for serial reproducibility is here brought to the fore. So what Heartfield's image does, alongside communicating a powerful anti-militarist message, is to dis- to stress the dialectical nature of technology, which has immense destructive power, but also immense political potential as an agent of ideological demystification. The question remains, of course, how Heartfield's image reached the public, and the answer is in a shop window. Heartfield's brother, Wieland Herzfelder, had established a left-wing publishing house, the Balik Verlag, in 1917. By 1924, the firm was flourishing and able to rent a broad-fronted shop in the Kürtenerstraße near the Kurfürstendamm in the fashionable shopping area of Berlin. In that same year, an anti-war window display appeared in the shop windows with Väter und Söhne, Fathers and Sons, the most prominent exhibit. So like Friedrich, Heartfield embraced the opportunities for public address opened up by consumer culture and the display window. But he situated his work actually far more squarely in the bourgeois heart of Berlin's commercial district in an attempt to shock. As with Friedrich, this is an attempt to control public space by projecting an affect-laden image outward from the shop into the street. And it's telling, actually, that Heartfield's own intentions, his own self-understanding of a photomonteur, was that as somebody who sought to affect the viewer corporeally. So he understood his work as delivering a blow to the stomach. And there's at least one account that suggests that he was more or less successful. So a bypasser kind of came into the shop and actually tried to tear down the montage before being physically kind of bundled out again. So that by way, in a sense, of a footnote to the earlier comments on Friedrich. So just to reach a few conclusions then, there are a few points worth making about the visual culture of pacifism in Weimar Germany. The first is the plurality of venues and modes of dissemination through which visual images were able to circulate, with Friedrich's case in particular highlighting the relay between the newspaper, the museum, the shop window, the photo book, and back into the newspaper. This in turn leads to a second conclusion, which relates to the nature of public discourse, what we might expect from it, and what it can actually achieve. There's much writing in photography studies in particular that presupposes or seeks a kind of linear causal relationship between photography and political action. So just one symptomatic title would be Vicky Goldberg's book, The Power of Photography, How Photographs Changed Our Lives. And yet the history of Weimar suggests that we should actually be quite cautious about making exaggerated claims for photography's political efficacy. As we've seen, much immediate reaction to Heartfield and Friedrich was either ad hominem, or it was action at the level of the signifier. Photographs were removed or defaced. But political change did not ensue. And perhaps one reason for this is to be found in the very nature of publics. So just to come back to Warner again, he writes, "All the verbs for public agency are verbs for private reading transposed upwards to the aggregate of readers. Readers may scrutinise, ask, reject, opine, decide, judge, and so on. Publics can do exactly these things, and nothing else. Publics, unlike mobs or crowds, are incapable of any activity that cannot be expressed through such a verb." So in other words, the constitution of a public is just a big scaling up of the act of reading. So even if we expand Warner's notion of a public to include publics that are constituted by means of the inhabitation of shared spaces, as I think we must, the general point still stands. Museum audiences, for example, are not mobs or crowds. Indeed, like many institutions of modernity, they work to dismantle or reduce the political power of the body. As we've seen in the examples of Friedrich and Heartfield, even the constitution of counterpublics by means of somatic and affective reactions does not guarantee that a public thus constituted will have significantly greater subversive power. This being the case, then, the hopes invested in public photographic discourse by pacifists, and indeed the fear of the Weimar authorities that such discourses could be efficacious, are equally unfounded. It's not an optimistic conclusion, but I think the history of Weimar suggests it's probably the right one. So, thank you.